in this special build edition of the AI show. Join us as we hear from Sarah Bird, Principal Program Manager on the ML Platform team, and Rob Melseri, Distinguished Engineer with Microsoft Core Operating Systems and Intelligent Edge team. Sarah will discuss differential privacy in practice with Rob, one of the major co-developers of the White Noise platform. Make sure you tune in.
I'm here at Build with Rob Melseri, who is one of the leaders of a team that pioneered the implementations of differential privacy inside of Microsoft and has been one of the major contributors to the White Noise platform. Hey, Rob, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Thanks, Sarah. Sure. I lead the central data engineering and data science teams for the core operating systems and intelligent edge group at Microsoft. So our team focuses on using diagnostic and other types of data signals to provide insights on the quality and experiences of devices running Windows. We build analytics, we train models, and we deploy predictive systems to improve the quality of all of those experiences.
Sounds like an awesome team. How did you get started with differential privacy?
Yeah, so you know, Windows runs on more than a billion devices in people's homes, in their businesses, and in data centers and more. And for many people, much of their daily lives are experienced through their PCs. So these are very personal devices, and their privacy matters. And this is true now more than ever. Trust has always been part of a core of what we do at Microsoft. And one of the strengths of Windows is support for a highly diverse hardware, software, and peripherals ecosystem with literally hundreds of millions of combinations and configurations out there. And so managing a complex ecosystem like Windows, that's challenging. Our users can choose to send data to help us keep systems secure and up to date, which is great, although we only collect the data for the purposes of keeping those devices up to date and secure. You know, we recognize that data could be misused. And this is where differential privacy comes in. It's just one of a wide range of measures that we employ to protect customers' data. On the front line, we have policy and security controls, encryption, data expiry, delete processors, auditing, and other kinds of controls. And we see differential privacy as a defense-in-depth type measure that can help protect customers from risks introduced downstream through different kinds of processing, reporting, dashboarding, machine learning models, et cetera.
So you mentioned that differential privacy protects from downstream data products, protects the downstream data products. Can you give an example of what you mean by that?
Yeah, sure. So one of the common things we do with data is dashboards and reporting. And dashboards help the leaders in the organization keep track of key roll-up metrics, things like counts, sums, averages, descriptive statistics. We usually aggregate the data into large partitions, so any individual's data isn't revealed. But there are various re-identification and reconstruction type attacks in the literature that can operate on exact aggregates like this. And so using differential privacy takes the guesswork out of that kind of protection for us. We can add a small amount of noise that has negligible impact on the overall accuracy, and we get protection from a lot of these kinds of attacks. You know, similarly, we use machine learning to build all kinds of predictive models, and these have similar privacy challenges. Machine learning models have a lot of free types of parameters that can sometimes be used to memorize private data, like metadata fingerprints from the data. And so people sometimes don't realize this because machine learning models are opaque. But differential privacy has this nice property that the privacy is preserved in post-processing. So we can pre-process features in the model to be differentially private, and then we can use our models so that they're not memorizing that private data.
That's amazing. So differential privacy was a pretty early stage research tech, and not a lot of people are using it in practice. How did your team get started developing it?
Yeah, so we've been using these technologies for a little more than 5 years now. We're fortunate in that the differential privacy research was developed out of Microsoft Research along with some other privacy technologies. And our first deployments of differential privacy came in the earliest planning for Windows 10. You know, we anticipated there would be a need for strong defense in depth for customer privacy. We worked closely with Microsoft Research and deployed a local model of differential privacy as part of the Windows telemetry platform in Windows 10.
In your opinion, is this technology something that normal companies can use, or are you going to need to have your own MSR on staff, right? How many privacy researchers does it take for deployment?
Yeah, it's a good question. We've learned a lot since the first deployments, for sure. And many teams within Microsoft are now using differential privacy, as well as other big tech companies using it. So the technology itself has become more mature. And we're starting to see tools from Microsoft and other companies that make it easier to use and implement differential privacy in your systems. For companies that collect data about individuals, it makes sense to check out differential privacy. And at the same time, differential privacy is just one piece of the puzzle. There's no silver bullet when it comes to privacy. Things we think of as table stake measures, strong user consent, encryption, data minimization, they're just as important, if not more so, than defense in depth measures like differential privacy.
So it sounds like tools are going to be key to making this technology more widely usable by more people. What tools do you use? Are you using publicly available tools or in-house tools?
Yeah. So we use a mix of internal and public tools. Microsoft, as I said, is a platform company, and we use our own platforms, of course. Initially, our differential privacy code was custom, one-off, written in a variety of languages in different parts of our product. But differential privacy, you know, it benefits from transparency. As technology and scenarios have matured, we wanted to shift to something that is more open source. Everyone benefits from being able to evaluate the algorithms in the open, making sure there aren't any bugs. And we wanted to save other organizations and companies some time if they're trying to implement differential privacy. And so we've been able to replace some of our custom code with the white noise core. And we plan to keep contributing and deploying this from the open source code base.
That's so cool. Thanks for sharing. It's amazing to see Windows doing such cool open source work. What does the future look like? Where do you see this technology going?
Well, looking ahead, I think we expect privacy-preserving technologies are going to be more important than ever, as the stakes for individuals' data and the associated risks around that data continue to go up. We're already seeing increased adoption of differential privacy and other methods across Microsoft and across the industry, but there's room for improvement, ease of application and integration into our tools especially. Like I said, Microsoft is a platform company, and our hope is to build these capabilities into more of our software and data platforms. So our customers who build solutions for others can also benefit and can better protect their customers' privacy as well. I'm really proud of the progress we've made so far and excited to be part of this journey with all of our partners inside and outside Microsoft. Thanks, Sarah.